So ends that brief chapter on the discussion of the Chacham Tzvi and the historical context of the Chacham Tzvi. Now I'd like to spend the next few minutes to share with you the historical context to this famous tshuva of the Chassam Sofer. Chassam Sofer is quoted, and as you have probably understood from these 2 days of discussions, one of the things which makes this particularly fascinating from a halachic perspective is the fact that there are just a handful of sources. Everybody is using the same sources to come to completely diametrically opposed conclusions. It's just an extraordinary thing. I mean, and when you invoke the Eilu ve'Eilu Divrei Elokim Chaim, you know, they are clearly both using the same sources. They're both using the same halachic tools. Yet they're coming to different conclusions. One of those handful of sources which people are discussing is the Chassam Sofer. What you may not realize, and I'm not going to go into the halachic analysis of the text of the Chassam Sofer, is you may not realize what the historical context was that led the Chassam Sofer to discuss the issue of death. There was no issue of brain death at that time. Brain death is a construct of the late 20th century. So what on earth was the Chassam Sofer talking about? What chapter of medical history led to his discussion, which also led, interestingly, to a very broad discussion in the halachic world about the definition of death? So what led to his discussion was this notion of the fear of premature burial, which hit Europe in the 18th and 19th centuries. And I'll explain presently what I'm talking about. In 1740, a man by the name of Jacques Benin Winslow wrote a book in the language of Latin. And the book was called Morte Incerte Signa, The Uncertainty of Death. In that book, he wrote, death is certain, since it is inevitable, but also uncertain, since its diagnosis is sometimes fallible. Now, had that book remained in Latin, it would have been relegated to obscurity, and nothing would have changed in the world. But as happenstance would have it, there was a man who was a physician and a translator of medical works by the name of Jean-Jacques Bruyère, and he took it upon himself not only to translate this work, but to go and go across the land and teach the contents of this work to share with people the fact that the signs of death are indeed uncertain, and it's quite possible that people are being misdiagnosed as dead. I just want to show you, actually, I'm not sure if I have it elsewhere. This is one of the illustrations of a coffin with the hand coming out of the coffin, perpetuating the fear that people were buried alive. And this notion, which was propagated by Bruyère, based on his translation, which he took upon himself to share with the world, became so widespread that it instilled fear in millions and millions of people in Europe that they would be buried alive. And they perpetuated these stories in literature. There's many stories. Edgar Allan Poe has a famous story of the premature burial. And there were stories in newspapers and stories in books and short stories and serial articles about opening up coffins and seeing scratch marks on the inside of the coffin. Horrifying stories which would frighten anybody. And as it was the practice, as remains the practice today, about capitalizing on people's fears, likewise was the case back then. And here you have a United States patent in 1868, issued August 25th, 1868. The nature of this invention consists in placing on the lid of the coffin and directly over the face of the body laid therein a square tube which extends from the coffin up through and over the surface of the grave. Said tube containing a ladder and a cord, one end of said cord being to a bell on the top of the square tube, so that should a person be interred ere life is extinct, he can, on recovery to consciousness, ascend from the grave and the coffin by the ladder, or if not able to ascend, ring the bell. Hence the term, saved by the bell. There's actually a debate in history whether saved by the bell originates from these premature burial coffins, or whether it has whether the boxing reference is indeed the real reference. And this is a similar one here, a mechanism whereby a set of pulleys is hooked up to the toes and to the fingers and to the head, which is intricately hooked up to a bell on top of the grave, that if a person should wake up while in their coffin and move their fingers or toes or head, they would indeed be able to ring the bell. Now, if anybody's there listening to the bell, that's another story. And they actually had they had shmira for people to stay in the cemeteries to see if these bells were being rung or not being rung. And to give you an idea of how long this fear persisted, this is an article from the Journal of the American Medical Association. You may have heard of it, from 1899, about the concern to prevent premature burials. Among the bills introduced before the New York State Legislature is one that deals with the matter of premature burials. So this is a very prevalent fear, and for those of you who are interested in a more extensive history of this, there's a wonderful history by Jan Bondesen called Buried Alive, which has wonderful literature and wonderful pictures. Now, some of you here may be familiar with the fact that in the 1700s, as a result of this literally worldwide spread fear that people would be buried alive, there were laws that were instituted in a number of countries, and one of them was by the Duke of Mecklenburg in Germany in 1772, who required all who were diagnosed as dead to be kept alive above ground for 3 days until putrefaction begins. So the only way people were confident that they were indeed dead was if gangrene set in. If they were starting to decompose, then you knew for sure that they were dead. So as you can imagine, this presented a serious halachic problem. Because after all, halacha is kavor tik berenu bayom hahu, you have to obligation to bury immediately that day. So do we now say, does the Jewish community of Mecklenburg and the surrounding communities that are bound by this law now say that since the law is now instituted, that burial should be delayed for 3 days, specifically because of concern that the person's still alive, should we delay burial and suspend the halacha and the obligation of immediate burial? Or should we say that our law is burial, we have our specific criteria about how death are defined, we will not accede to the worries and concerns of the rest of the world about how these patients might be misdiagnosed as being dead. And that history led to the tshuva of the Chasan Sofer. And this discussion about whether burial should be done in 3 days, not 3 days, was probably, I can say relatively safely, as complicated and as long and involving all of the gedolim of that generation as this brain death issue. It carried on for decades. Any of the major poskim of that time all weighed in on this 3-day burial controversy, in essence, to determine whether death had occurred or not had occurred by the age-old criteria that we had been using. So therein is the context of the Chasan Sofer. Shalom v'chol tuv, etc. Yikar tohi giyani v'nafshoi yikrevu shelason yidon yirachas in one city, sherofei kohen. It just so happened that there was a doctor who was a kohen. Uminimusei hamedina she'en ha'meisim nigbarim ad achar shebadku arofei umeid alav shenis yayish achar nefalo imutu l'kohen l'kanes alpi afil ligali dover. So the question was, they kept these people above ground for days, and they needed a certification of a physician to determine whether the patient was dead or alive, and that the physician in this case happened to be a Kohen, and that was the context. Now, I don't know if it came up in the discussion today, and please stop me if it did, that the question was posed to him by the Maritz Chayes, and this is one of the few cases where the Chasan Sofer does not mention who the question was from. He just says, Charetz Amuflog, etc., etc. Av Beis Din Rosh Masifta Dekil Gadosha Ploni. He doesn't say who he's asking, who the questioner was. It's one of the very few instances. I can't say I've read all the tshuvos of the Chasan Sofer to say how many others. But the reason is because he attacks him so virulently that out of kavod for the individual, he left out, he omitted the name. But the Maritz Chayes actually printed this tshuva in his tshuvas, and we know that the Maritz Chayes was the one who posed the question to him. This fear of death, of premature or misdiagnosis of death, is actually been perpetuated not in the same intensity in our generation, in our age, but it is to some extent. And I apologize, this doesn't read so well, but I'll read it to you. So, for example, a Tel Aviv woman returns from the dead. Jerusalem Post, August 30th, 2001. Tel Aviv Burial Society members who were preparing the body for Tara got the surprise of their lives. The body began to breathe. So you'll read periodically cases. And in this is in Vietnam in 2003, in 2003 again, in 2004, 2005. Every year you'll have a handful of cases of people that were believed to be dead. So the question is, and this is a fear in the transplant community also, are these people who are diagnosed brain dead, is there a misdiagnosis of their death? Are they really not dead? Are they going to wake up and come back to me the way they were before? And this is a genuine fear. But as far as we know, based on the medicine now, brain death, as we understand it, is 100% irreversible. And while you have these cases that I mentioned to you and cases in the Star and the Inquirer also as well, there has not been one case ever in the history of the medical literature since the inception of the diagnosis of brain death of any individual regaining consciousness or recovery from the brain death state. So it is an inexorable pathway to cessation of life. Now, the pathway can take a longer period of time, a shorter period of time. That, I'm sure, was discussed yesterday. This is a concern about the misdiagnosis of death here. Bad news, Dad, you're brain dead. This we don't need. This I just put in because I couldn't resist putting it in. Because you invariably discuss the physiological decapitation of death. So I think all Poskim would agree in this case, based on the Mishnah and Olos, that this person was indeed dead. Actually, I just left this in because I don't know if you discussed the position of Rav Schechter. I'm sure you discussed the brain death position, non-brain death. So just one minute, just for the sake of completeness, so you have one of our Gedolia Poskim's position represented here. Rav Schechter has, and I apologize, I don't want to misrepresent it, I'm going to state it very briefly, but Rav Schechter has a different approach to the definition of death than other Poskim, an entirely different approach. And his approach is based on the fact that there were three, according to the Gemara, there are three organs that are called Evarim Shehaneshama Teluya Bohem. These are organs that have a soul, in a certain sense, connected with them. And to make it very brief, he says that it is the circulation specifically which defines life. Circulation, not the heart pumping, not the brain functioning, circulation. But circulation not only to the heart, circulation to the three major organs, circulation to the liver, to the heart, and to the brain. And he entertains different scenarios. If circulation to one of them stops, is the person considered dead? If all three of them stop, etc. And has a lengthy analysis along that vein. Parenthetically, and if Schechter is aware of this as well, but I'm not sure if he knows the exact reference or specifics, but this notion which finds its expression in the Gemara of the Gimel Evarim Shehaneshama Teluya Bohem, the three organs which have souls connected with them, was not a uniquely Talmudic belief. That also was a belief common in antiquity. This is a chart of the physiology according to Galen. To give you an idea, when Galen lived, he was a contemporary of Rabbi Yehuda HaNasi in the second century of the Common Era. This isn't a drawing from him, but it's a drawing about his works, where he shows the different spirits and the different souls. And there's one in the brain, and there's one in the natural spirit in the liver, and there's one in the heart as well. And that's the Gimel Evarim Shehaneshama Teluya Bohem. And now for the last few minutes, I'll discuss the issue of a donation after cardiac death. So just in conclusion of that section, I hope that this historical analysis has enlightened to some extent. Again, my objective is purely to present these so that people can hopefully understand the sources better, how people choose to use this, whether they use it in the Psak Halacha, that is purely in the realm of the Poskim, not at all in my realm.